congregation. My name is Carol Elrod, and I will be leading our service today. This month, our theme is the unexpected. Here at All Faiths, you will find a diverse and inclusive spiritual community where we welcome people with many beliefs. You can bring your whole self, your full identity, your questioning mind, and your expansive heart. At All Faiths, we have more than one way of experiencing the world and understanding the sacred. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on your spiritual journey, and whomever you love, you are truly welcome here. I have a few announcements this morning. Lee Interfaith for Empowerment, or LIFE, will hold its annual assembly on Monday, November 9th at 7 p.m. Congregants who committed to being network members should have received a link to register for the virtual gathering from their team leader. The new issue that LIFE will undertake in the upcoming year will be decided at this meeting, so please attend. Contact Marcia Bates if you have questions. This month, we are collecting money for Operation Joy, and that is Share the Plate, where 10% goes to the charity that we've chosen. So if you intend to contribute to that, write Operation Joy in the memo line of your check. Okay, for other events that are going on, please check your emails and the happening calendar. Let us now sing together hymn number 361, Enter, Rejoice, and Come In. We light this flame to ignite the sacred power of justice. We light this flame so that it may be a beacon of hope in moments of uncertainty, fear, anxiety, and the unknown. We light this flame and are emboldened by its blaze, knowing that our strength as a prophetic and powerful people is rooted in the diverse ways that we answer the call to love.
This is the day that has been made for us. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please join in singing our youth to their religious education classes. Go now in peace.
Go now in peace, go now in peace. May the spirit of love surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go.
Please close your eyes, take a deep breath, and let us turn our hearts to today's service and the unexpected. Please join in singing hymn number 123, Spirit of Life.
Share our joys and sorrows that we have felt with the congregation. And as we are apart, we still have that opportunity. If you'd like to share a joy or sorrow, please contact me and I'll be sure to include it in the service on Sunday. This morning we hold Greg Monk in our hearts. He is in a VA hospital in St. Petersburg with COVID-19. Being treated. We hold in our hearts Howard Silverman, who had surgery this week. We hold in our hearts Bob and Fran Way and their family, who have all tested positive for COVID-19. And this week we celebrate with some of our members and friends. Happy birthday to Linda Runkel, which her birthday was on the 5th. Ariel Hoover, Doug Deininger, and Mildred Smith. Let us share a few moments of silence to hold all of these in our hearts.
We are working to be free.
More of what we think we need to accomplish. And it may seem less stressful at first, being able to anticipate what happens next. But after a certain amount of time, and that amount would vary person to person, the once comfortable predictability would become less comfortable and, well, boring. If we always know what happens next, we lose the joy of surprise, serendipitous experiences, and the excitement that comes from anticipating the unknown. Friends, let us gather with open, curious hearts, ready to explore the unpredictable, learn from its wisdom, and embrace its beauty. The hymn of preparation this morning is number 20, Be Thou My Vision. The words are printed at the bottom of your order of service.
Thou my best, thou by day or by night.
What a week it has been. I told you last Sunday to expect the unexpected. And I can't tell you how difficult it was for me to wake up each day and watch the electoral votes not moving one way or the other. And Nevada, Arizona, Pennsylvania, and Georgia, I apologize for everything I said about you. For me, it was like peeling a Band-Aid off my hairy arm slowly and painfully. And my rational self understood why patience was needed. And as President-elect Biden, that sounds nice, doesn't it? As President-elect Biden stated, each vote was a person participating in democracy, and that each vote needed to be counted. We were all sitting, I know, on the edge of our seats and biting our nails. We knew what was at stake. We knew the possibility of hope, of justice, of compassion. They were all so close. And then Saturday morning, or was it afternoon, we received word of a promising presidency. The waiting, the anxiety, the longing had ended. And I must tell you, though I was satisfied, I was left feeling emotionally deflated. For 4 years, I have been on the edge. For 4 years, I have been on alert, building a ministry, battling racism, injustice, bigotry, hate, unfairness, and corruption, and comforting those caught up in this battle, urging them to hang in and to hang on, not knowing what the future may bring. When all of that was lifted, I was left with a feeling of exhaustion, yet a feeling that I had been freed. And I wonder if you felt the same way. We do have reason to celebrate this morning, but after the balloons have deflated and the confetti has been swept away, we have work to do. Change does not come with only an election. This is why I say we are the prophets of our time, because it is by our work, our compassion, and our seeking justice and equity, our prophetic witness, that we can produce the outcomes that we desire. It is an incredible responsibility, and I'm sure we are sometimes reluctant to call ourselves prophets of our time. And when modern folks talk about prophets and prophecy, they're referring to some foretelling of future events. However, in Scripture, the prophets played a much larger role. And religiously, we've been taught, we've learned that prophets are human and they speak on God's behalf. Some of their messages are more dramatic than others. Some prophets, like Ezekiel and Zechariah, see elaborate visions, while others simply call people to remember their allegiance to Israel's God and the Torah, like Malachi. And in Scripture, and especially in the Old Testament, a prophet has the role of holding people accountable. They do this through the ministry of prophecy. When you encounter prophecy in Scripture, it usually refers to a message claiming to be of divine nature or origin. And since most of the Bible focuses on the ancient Israelites' relationship with their God, it makes sense that most of the Bible's prophecy comes from the same God. These messages come in many forms: dreams, poetry, sermons, and even dramatic physical stunts, like in Isaiah, when the prophet went nude for 3 years to signify how the Assyrians would strip and shame the Egyptians. And just for the record, I am not encouraging such behavior from anyone in our congregation. It's easy to think of prophecy as a message concerning the future. The prophets of the Bible speak of the past, present, and future, and so should we. Historically, true prophets spoke about injustice and exploitation. They spoke when people went astray and forgot the poor. They punched up and not down. They spoke truth to power. They didn't condemn people, didn't condemn the downtrodden and the marginalized. There are a whole lot of people that call themselves prophets today, but most of them barely acknowledge poverty, exploitation, or injustice. And Jesus knew this, and that's why he warned us that there will always be a bunch of false prophets and false teachers running their mouths who will deceive many people. Historically, there were two types of prophets. Firstly, there were those who feasted at the king's table because they had co-opted to speak well of evil leaders. They were always bringing these smarmy words of favor and influence of prosperity to the king, and the king lapped it up. And secondly, there were those who were exiled to the caves or beheaded like John the Baptist, and that's who we would be today, because they spoke out about the injustice of immorality of their leaders. The king didn't like them very much, and he tried to have them kneecapped. Well, my friends, this morning, this weekend, we have come out of exile. I would suggest to you that the leaders of the religious right in America and the so-called prophetic leaders of the charismatic and evangelical church have become the false prophets of this generation. When you offer support and resources to those in power and oppress and become a mechanism for divisiveness, you are no longer able to claim prophecy. Therefore, I call us Unitarian Universalists prophets of our time. In our Unitarian Universalist faith, we live a living faith. We live change. We work to change and offer prophetic witness to all that ails our community, our country, and in the world. We warn others. Listen to the words of the prophets in Scripture. You will hear our Unitarian Universalist cries. Amos the prophet warned, "Hear this, you who trample the needy and destroy the poor of the land." Isaiah the prophet, "Seek justice, correct oppression, bring justice to the fatherless, plead the widow's cause." Jeremiah the prophet, "Woe to him who builds his house by unrighteousness and his upper rooms by injustice." Ezekiel the prophet, "Behold, this was the guilt of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters had pride, excess of food, and prosperous ease, but did not aid the poor and the needy." Micah the prophet, "He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly." Zechariah the prophet, "Do not oppress the widow, the fatherless, the immigrant, or the poor." A prophet is someone who is willing to face the fact that we are in a predicament, and it's only as we co-participate with our better selves, our spiritual selves, our community of prophets, can we find ourselves moving in the direction of a beloved community. So when I think about what it means to be prophetic, I think it means to identify with some clarity and boldness the kinds of political and economic practices that contradict the purposes of our faith. And if they contradict the purposes of our faith, they will come to no good end. So if you think about racism, economic injustice, or if you think about ecological abuse of the environment, it is the path of disaster. And the prophets of the Old Testament traced the path of disaster. And it seems to me that our work now is to trace the path of disaster in which we are engaged. And the amazing thing. The amazing thing about the prophets is that they were able to pivot after they had done that, to talk with confidence that their faith was working out an alternative world of well-being, justice, and peace, and security in spite of the contradiction. So they were in the ancient world. They were courageous. And the prophets that we can identify now have the same kind of courage. As prophets of our time, we have that same kind of courage. If you can declare something in the here and now about the human predicament, take seriously what is going on in our world, that we live in death-dealing circumstances that marginalize, victimize those persons who are already vulnerable, and in America you have such a dichotomy between the privileged and the disenfranchised and marginalized that it's really pronounced to me where the predicaments are. So if we're going to talk about prophetic consciousness, I don't think that that means some mystical apparatus. I think it means the capacity to imagine the world seen through the eyes of the Unitarian Universalist faith and tradition, and becoming the prophets of our time. Liberal Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann tells us, "I think people think being prophetic is just nagging people about social justice, and you wear people out nagging them. And what that misses on the one hand is social analysis. You're just not nagging about social justice if you don't do social analysis. And the other side of it is that prophetic faith is elementally hopeful that something better is intended and will come to fruition. That generally is missed among liberals about being prophetic. So I ask you, are we ready to wake up and continue to do the work more fiercely and more faithfully than ever? And let's be clear, this is not a politically partisan thing. Liberals and conservatives both have a ton of waking up to do. One unemployed Michigan factory worker was quoted after the election saying, "I vote Republican because I won't vote for anyone who doesn't see and respect me." And on the other side of the political fence, Black, Latino, Muslim, LGBTQ families are struggling with real fear about what's been unleashed and what may be unleashed against them in the coming weeks. And they are wondering if this country will wake up to take their fear seriously. And the bottom line is, we need prophetic communities now more than ever. We need prophetic communities such as All Faiths now more than ever. As Unitarian Rebecca Parker says, we need circles of brave and bold people who are willing to see what is happening, to say what is happening, and to act in accordance with what they know. And this means that being a community of prophecy is not just about helping people wake up to each other's realities and fears. There is also work is about finding common ground among differing worldviews. But sometimes this work is about prophetic judgment and knowing when some views need to be opposed. As the activist once said, "I am not crushed, I am awake." There are so many ways for us to wake up, so many people who need to do so. So let us be awake. And in the end, maybe that is the most prophetic message of all. That is the most prophetic message we need to continue our Unitarian Universalist work in the world. May it be so. You may know that at the time of the offertory, I offer a joke each Sunday. But before I do, I want to thank everyone for their generosity and the donations that help us to do the work of this congregation. If this service is reaching you and you are far away and not a member or a friend of this congregation, but find our services comforting, I ask you to please consider supporting us and making a donation. You can do that by using the address and the website in the comments below this video. Mr. Green peered over his fence and noticed that the neighbor's little boy was in his backyard filling a hole. Curious about what the boy was up to, Mr. Green asked, "What are you doing, Jimmy?" And tearfully, little Jimmy said, "My goldfish died and I'm going to bury him." "And that's an awfully large hole for a goldfish, isn't it?" Mr. Green said. And patting down the last bit of earth, Jimmy replied, "Well, that's because my goldfish is in your path." The offering will now be given and received. Whispered Let our hearts be lighter. Let our spirits be renewed, and let our souls be healed. Let us be the light we want to see in the world. Blessed be.
Oh, to heaven.
We thank the Reverend CJ McGregor for the message, Joseph Brauer for the beautiful music, Regina Kilmartin for operating the camera, and Ed Elrod on sound. As I extinguish the chalice, please read in unison the words for the chalice extinguishing printed in your order of service. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world.